Hello to Radio Algeria International, and I want to express my pride and pride on behalf of all the team of Radio Algeria International for having an exclusive interview with you. Today I have with me Chief Mandela, the grandson of Nelson Mandela and member of the South African Parliament and the Pan-African Parliament. So hello and welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here, and hello to your listeners.
Thank you very much. So you are here as part of your participation in the sixth conference, the sixth international conference on the right of people to resist, and that which is the case of the Western Sahara people. And this conference is due to be held tomorrow and the day after here in Algiers.
Yes, absolutely. We are here on the invitation to attend the conference on the plight and the struggle for liberation of the Sahrawi people, and they are seek to achieve self-determination. But I think most importantly for us as the Mandela family, we this year are celebrating the centennial year of my grandfather Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela, the founding father for our young nascent democracy, who in the early 60s took upon a journey to come into Africa, visited 16 countries in a passport, an Ethiopian passport that was issued by the Emperor Haile Selassie, and he was able on his journey to come to Algeria and receive his military training here. For us, it is a really a great honor and a privilege to be able to undertake a journey in Madiba's footsteps.
Mm-hmm. So how did Nelson Mandela regard Algeria?
My grandfather regarded Algeria to be his second home. Mm-hmm. This was a home for him that ushered in a new dawn. My grandfather's generation of 1944 was able to establish the ANC Youth League, led by the then Pan-Africanist leader Anton Lembede, with the likes of Ashley Pitamda, Oliver Tambo, Walter Sisulu, Lillian Ngoyi, Robert Sobukwe. In founding the ANC Youth League, they had a clear approach to it, that they wanted to end the passive resistance of signing petitions against an oppressive and a brutal regime. Therefore, they adopted a militant approach where they would be able to engage with the apartheid regime directly in acts of protest and defiance. So when my grandfather came in to Africa seeking to mobilize support for our struggle for liberation, he came to Algeria to receive his military training as the commander-in-chief of Mkhonto weSizwe. But what was important on that visit is the lifetime friendship he was able to achieve. We came here and met the likes of Comrade Ambassador Judy, who my grandfather regarded not just as a friend, but a brother and comrade in arms, with the likes of the late Jamal, that my grandfather also regarded to be a very close comrade in arms to him. But I think being here in Algeria and being able to see the people that shaped my grandfather's understanding of a militant campaign that ensured that we had a turning point in our history. It was on this very grounds that my grandfather began crisscrossing the entire continent through meeting leaders and revolutionaries like Augustino Neto, Tovio Natovio, that were leaders of their own. And it was through the Algerian support that he was able to grow this network, which the ANC and the later leaders within the African National Congress would be able to build a strong relationship on, like President Oliver Tambo.
Mm-hmm. So speaking about the conference, what are the major points that are going to be tackled?
Well, for us as the Mandela family, as well as the ANC, we have a simple and clear message. And our message really stands out from what my grandfather perceived in. We treat every country in the manner that it treated our own struggle for liberation. So the issue of Algeria's relationship with us, as well as the issue of Polisario and the Sahrawi people as republic, is a relationship of not only friends, but comrades in arms, because these are our comrades that understood our pain, understood our suffering during our darkest days of apartheid. Mm-hmm. They stood side by side with us and not only supported us in words, but placed resources to our disposal to be able to lead an effective campaign against a brutal and oppressive regime of apartheid. And now that we are free and we have been able to achieve our freedom through their assistance, we want to assure them, the Sahrawi people, that their contribution is not forgotten. Mm-hmm. What they did for us, it is our time to return the favor. It is our time to ensure that their pain now becomes our pain. Their suffering becomes our suffering. And like my grandfather said to the Palestinians when he visited Gaza, that our freedom as South Africans is incomplete without the freedom of the Palestinians. I dare say today, our freedom is not incomplete as South Africa without the freedom of the Sahrawi people. And I'm proud to come to this conference right after we have finished our 54th National Conference as the African National Congress, where we sent a clear message on the doubts that were being casted with the President's visit, His Excellency President Zuma's visit to Morocco, where it was being manipulated that South Africa's commitment was now swaying in favor of Moroccans. We know exactly who Morocco is. We know the role Morocco played during our own plight of the struggle against apartheid in South Africa. We know of the weapons that they were procuring out of South Africa. I came from the refugee camps in the past 2 days. I saw with my own eyes the tanks that were captured by Polisario and were to be used against our own brothers and sisters in their plight for self-determination. Therefore, the ANC 54th National Conference took a clear resolution to pass an unwavering support towards the Sahrawi people, to say that we stand firm with them and we want to ensure that the resolution of the United Nations, that they should be able to have a referendum. We want that resolution to be quickly implemented so that we can be able to fast track and be able to realize the freedom of Western Sahara.
I bet the Sahrawi people will be really relieved after hearing what you have just said. Still with Western Sahara, what does the participation of the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic in the last AU-EU summit represent?
For us, it has been very important, particularly to look at what has transpired out of that. And we want to clearly state that we condemn the withdrawal of Morocco from being held accountable. But we must applaud the European Court of Justice for recognizing the sovereignty of Western Sahara, to ensure that the sovereignty of its land and international waters is recognized. And I hope that this sends a clear message to the Moroccan apartheid regime that we will not rest until the last colony of Africa is set free, until the last colony of Africa realizes its freedom. We cannot, as the African continent, champion the decolonization of Africa and yet be silent when one of our own brothers and sisters are suffering under an oppressive regime such as that of apartheid Morocco.
So if I ask you to give us a comment about the European countries' proposal to extend the EU-Moroccan fisheries accord in spite of the ruling of this same accord by the European Union or by the European Court of Justice itself.
We certainly condemn that. We want to send a strong message to the EU that they should recognize the decision of the European Court of Justice and uphold the sovereignty of Western Sahara. And perhaps the onus is on us as Africans to really come together on this issue through our regions, as well as through the Pan-African Parliament and the African Union, to take lead of this issue. Because it is an issue located in the African continent. We can no longer be passive and play a secondary role to an issue that is paramount to our own freedom of realizing a free and decolonized Africa. Therefore, we call upon all our liberation movements and all our countries within the AU to be in support of the struggle for self-determination of the Sahrawi people.
South Africa had experienced genocide, marginalization, and maybe all forms of human rights violation during the apartheid era. So it's the same case with the Sahrawi people right now. So for, if I ask you to give us your opinion, or for maybe what's the policy that should be adopted by the Sahrawi people in order to get rid of that?
I think ours has not been as harsh as what we are witnessing in Western Sahara.
So you're saying that what's happening there in Western Sahara of human rights violation is more even than what happened in the apartheid era?
It's the most brutal that I've personally come across. The population statistics on their own show you that there hasn't been a population growth in Western Sahara. If the population was regarded to be sitting at about 9-10 million people a century ago, it is still the same numbers. And that tells you volumes about what is happening in Western Sahara. What we experienced in South Africa was silencing the majority to be submissive to white supremacists. We were to become cheap migrant laborers to serve our white bosses. It's not the case with the Sahrawi people. It's a total elimination of an entire generation and entire race of people. And we condemn this in the harshest manner it deserves. We want to say that even during our darkest days, Polisario as well and the Sahrawi people stood side by side with us in order to fight the apartheid regime. And we devised a number of strategies to ensure that we were able to lead an effective campaign against the apartheid regime. The African National Congress, from inception, has been a non-racial and a non-sexist organization. Therefore, we were able to mobilize South Africans in their vast majority across racial boundaries, but also across all sexes, to ensure that the vast majority of South Africans supported our struggle for liberation. The African National Congress did not work in isolation to deliver our freedom. We worked with the likes of the Natal Indian Congress, the Transvaal Indian Congress, the Colored People's Congress, which came to be known as the Congress movements. There is a famous pact known as the Doctors' Pact, which is of Dr. Xuma, Dr. Naika, and Dr. Dadu, which brought together coloreds, Indians, and Africans as the Congress movement. And the leadership of the African National Congress ensured that race was not utilized to divide us. We were able to unite against one common enemy, which was an apartheid oppressive regime. And I think the greatest tool here for the Sahrawi people is to ensure that they never give up hope. They unite across all party lines. All activists need to come together and speak as one voice and speak for the plight that the Sahrawi people are facing. We have witnessed in our very own trip the brutality that is being exerted by apartheid Moroccan regime towards the occupied Western Sahara territories. We are witnessing the brutality that is exerted on women and children like we have never before experienced in South Africa. We are witnessing the disappearance of thousands of political prisoners and civil prisoners. It is estimated that over 4,500 prisoners have disappeared and have not been accounted for. This is totally unlike what we experienced. And we want to say that even Madiba and his collective never lost hope that they would achieve their freedom in their lifetime. And that is our message on this trip. While we trace Madiba's footsteps in this 100th centennial year, we want to say to the Sahrawi people that they should never give up hope. They should intensify their campaign for self-determination and always know that they are brothers and sisters in South Africa and throughout the continent where the liberation movements reside. We will always be in their support.
That is very serious. I really hope that the international community will react upon that. Back to the conference. One of the conference's major points of focus is to break or end the media blackout imposed by the Moroccan colonizer on Western Sahara. How important is the media in promoting the Sahrawi people's rights to the international scene?
It is very important, first and foremost, for the Sahrawi people to be able to utilize the media to have an effective voice in the international sector. I think having been able as the African Union to welcome back Morocco as a participant, we have to be able to hold it accountable for some of the policies that we embrace. The freedom of expression, the freedom of free media coverage. And with such, we have to be able to insist that journalists are given an opportunity to cover the atrocities that are being experienced in Western Sahara. If Morocco has nothing to hide, if Morocco is a saint and clean from such accusations, then it should be called to prove to the rest of the world. It has refused a UN delegation's own exercise to go and be able to do a trip on a fact-finding mission. It has refused the African Union. Clearly, there is a lot that it has to hide. And we are saying that in today's world, where a cell phone is a tool for expression, we should be able to say the young people, women and children in occupied Western Sahara should be able to utilize their phones and be able to cover any wrongdoings and any atrocities and upload them on social media through Twitter, through Instagram, so that they are able to inform the world of what they are experiencing internally in occupied Western Sahara.
The ANC has always been one of the major advocates of the right of people to their natural resources and riches, and that was shown lately by declaring Western Sahara as the only owner of the phosphate cargo carried in the cherry blossom vessel. What's the message to be extracted from that?
Well, we draw a simple understanding which is derived from the Freedom Charter. In the Freedom Charter, it was enshrined that the land belongs to all people who live in it. And it is that simple understanding that we're saying that all the minerals and the riches of Western Sahara belong to the Sahrawi people. And all that is found, whether be on land and international waters, belong to the sovereign right of Western Sahara. And we will do everything to our power to ensure that where there is wrongdoing on that, we are able to correct that. And I think some of the successful cases that we have been able to pass has been the confiscating of illegal phosphate that has been taken out of Western Sahara. For us, it is an injustice of stripping the wealth out of the Sahrawi people when it has been clearly illustrated by the European Court of Justice that Western Sahara enjoys its own separate sovereignty, such and equal to Morocco as a sovereign state.
Thank you very much for this beautiful ending and for your explanations. And I wish you a very good stay in your second home, Algeria.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.